Good morning. This is Stan in Gainesville, Florida, and you are listening to Light Talk.
Hi, this is Steve in Dallas, Texas, and today we're talking about international gigs. We're talking about freezing at the light board and all kinds of things. We're talking about physics in Turkey.
Physics in Turkey.
All that today on Light Talk.
Turkish physics?
I've never heard of such a thing. And this is David in Long Beach, California. And if you don't already know by this drawn-out introduction, you are listening to Light Talk, and we are the Lumen Brothers.
We are.
Yeah, we're back. Stan and I made it back from USITT in one piece, which is great. We got a huge show today, and we're going to see how short we can make it. But there's a lot to talk about. And one of the things we're going to talk about later is USITT and some of the things that we saw there and some of the things we learned there, which is really interesting. But let's first talk about last week's show with Ann McMills.
I have good news about Ann McMills.
What's that?
Anne has agreed to do the first episode of each month with Light Talk now. She has set aside some time. She is now going to be a regular.
A regular?
I love it.
That's wonderful.
Did you check with the front office about that?
Yeah, really. We got to get her to sign a disclaimer.
A non-disclosure agreement.
These guys are crazy.
And you hear that? You have to sign an NDA to work with us. No,
she knows. Kidding. She knows better. But she's questioning this decision because, you know, after last week's show, yeah, I think we could be really doing some serious damage to her career.
Well, she is. She is our censor, you know.
Well, she's our good taste monitor.
Right. Well, same thing.
Yeah, but considering our taste has not improved that much, I don't know what sort of job she's doing. But anyway, let's get on because we gotta make this a fast show. Steve has some exciting industry news.
Yeah, I just wanted to remind everyone that coming up soon, May the 13th, still a little time out, Design Showcase East will be presenting BFA and MFA graduate design portfolios in New York. And, of course, Design Showcase West will be at the UCLA campus June 1st. So if you're on the East Coast, West Coast, please come and join us at our showcases.
Yeah, those showcases are fantastic. I went to both of them last year. And the one that Steve has on the East Coast, that's really cool. You can do it at Ailey again?
Yes, Ailey is our new home. We had been talking to them for a while. They were redesigning their studios, and they made a space for us there, and it's great. You know, so we can handle 50 portfolios now with no trouble.
That's a beautiful space, by the way. So please stop by. And, of course, Showcase West is always great, too. So, yeah, East Coast, West Coast, on both coasts, baby. That's great.
Nothing in the South. Right. Nothing in the South. What can I say?
So, David, I hear you have some interesting news about next week's episode.
Next week, that's right, because this is episode 103. And do you know what that means, Stan?
Something special.
Not this show, but next week is coming up our second anniversary show. Next week.
Oh, yeah, but don't tell them what that
is. Oh, no, it's a surprise.
It's 104.
Right. You already gave it away, Stan. Last week you said what it was.
I don't have a memory.
Although last week we had a huge number of downloads.
How many?
It was a lot. It was like over 1,500. It was huge. It was huge.
You know, let me just say, I got a few. We got some really good interviews lined up if everybody shows up.
Oh, like who? Who's coming?
Everybody wants to be on the show. Well, there's a guy in New York. He's done a lot of musicals. He's sort of a big name. We tried to have him before. He is scheduled to tape with us. So if nothing gets in the way, we should have Ken Billington.
Ken Billington.
And, we do have another New York-based designer lined up, and that's Herrick Goldman.
Oh,
wow. And then just recently, because we bumped into him at USITT, we've got Richard Cadena. So there's some really great lighting people who have said they'll spend an hour of their time with us to add to the pantheon of Light Talk interviews.
Well, first of all, Richard Cadena, have you seen his business card?
I did. You guys have been ribbing each other about that.
Come on. And he claims that he's better looking than Bobby. And I'm sorry.
Well, it's a tie. It's close. He's good looking. I saw him.
We also have Dawn Chang and Tom Littrell from ETC. We're excited that Tom's going to be there. And a very special guest, Elaine McCarthy. So he was like one of the great projection designers.
That's a lot of people lined up, man.
All for season 3, which starts... Does it start today? No, next week. Does it start on 104? Does it start 105? I guess 105 is season 3, right?
You think we'll ever run out of people?
We'll never run out of people.
You know what'll happen is, like, in 20 years, when we're, like, really old, we'll be interviewing our former students.
How old is really old? In 20 years, I'll be 83.
87. 87.
Oh, God. All right. Hey, have you seen my new license plate from my Tesla?
Oh, I did. You just couldn't help but show it off.
I bought a vanity plate. Oh, Kaya's very happy about that.
You have way too much invested in this podcast.
I do. I do. But now I can deduct my entire car. So that's great.
Oh, my God.
Anyway, don't let the IRS know about that.
The IRS is listening.
Anyway, Steve has our first question.
It's from Diana in Boston. And she asks, I want to work internationally. How did you guys get your international gigs? Do you have any advice on how I can break into that world?
I have the same question.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't have a lot of international work, not in theater. So I'm really curious to hear the answers.
Well, my first series of international work was as a lighting supervisor. So a designer had designed a show, and then I was brought on board to take the show to Europe and to recreate his work. Not make it better, certainly not make it worse, but recreate the work. So I came on as a lighting supervisor. Then eventually I joined a company as a principal designer for their work, and we toured the world and still do. Once I started touring, I started meeting other people overseas. Companies started bringing me back to Europe and to Asia to work with them because they liked my work. It's, you know, it's as simple and as difficult as it sounds. get your first job.
That's a good answer
there. Probably as a lighting supervisor. Dance companies do it all the time. And don't be a jerk when you travel outside the country and hand your business card to people. It helps if you speak a language. That's going to make a big difference if you're trying to get a job as a lighting supervisor. When I got my first job, the tour was going to China. To mainland China, and the artistic director was interviewing me and said, is there anything you would like to tell me? And I said, I think what I'd like to tell you is that I am fluent in Mandarin. And she lost her mind. She was just like, I can't believe it. And I said, well, that's what I would like to tell you, but I don't speak a bit of Mandarin. And she
now
she just started laughing, and she said, you'll be fun to have along. And so that's kind of how it started.
That's fantastic.
I do a lot of work in France. Mm-hmm. I met some theater people there, and I have friends there. So again, it's connections.
Yeah, it always is connections. It's really, you know, I was joking earlier, but it's true. It's the director. You've got to find a director who works in Europe. That, you know, that's how it happened for me. I mean, I had a career mostly in regional theater and opera for like 30 years, and I did one show in Europe during that time. And then all of a sudden I met Paul Curran, and all of a sudden I'm doing all my shows in Europe and Asia and Scandinavia. You know, I mean, it's where the director works is where you're going to work. And you know, Ken Kazan, another director who I work with all the time, he does European shows too. So it really depends on the director. But yes, yeah, Steve, you're absolutely correct. If you get involved in being a lighting coordinator for a company, like a dance company, yeah, you're going to meet people. And in this business, it's who you meet. That's the bottom line.
I have one other thought. It wouldn't hurt if you can, I don't know, if you can put the money together to go to the Prague Quadrennial and start and see what's happening on the international market and meet some people. It wouldn't hurt to go to a couple of the big lighting conferences that happen in Europe. I know that sounds outrageous, but there are events beyond trade shows where lighting designers come together and talk about the artistry of design. I had a student who did that a few years ago. He went to Czechoslovakia to a conference, and I just thought that was the craziest thing in the world. But he was good at what he did. He was a friendly person, and he just started meeting people. And, you know, it's interesting. He met Jules Fischer, and they would have breakfast together and chat, and he would point him in some direction. So I think you got to get your name out there, and you're going to have to maybe dig around a bit.
Well, I didn't think my story was really going to be relevant to this, but I did get international work, but in a very serendipitous path. And I think to Steve's point about conferences, I got a grant to develop a lighting class, and to pick up the money, the granting agency was at Lightfair, which is architectural lighting, but it's an international conference in the United States. And here's maybe a little hint. I'm sort of a weird one in that I walk around the edges of the conferences to see all the little small booths.
Oh, I love
booths,
that. I love that.
Right, that are not that are the guys who were tinkering in their garages, right? And I met these guys who made these little fiber optic lights, and I said, "Oh, these are the coolest things I've ever seen. What do you do with these?" And they said, "Well, we light up museum artifacts with this." And I said, "Oh, this I've always dreamed about this for theater models." And so we became friends, and we exchanged information. And the next thing I knew, I was meeting the president of that company. And the next thing I knew, he worked internationally. The next thing I knew, they were taking me to museums around the world to work with them. And so it is about meeting people, and that's just how it happens. So I guess there's a variety of ways. It didn't happen for me for theater, but it happened for me for museums. But I'm very thankful for what I learned from that and all the knowledge I gained and the travel as well. But I didn't have – so you just never know. But like these guys have said, get your name out there, go places where you might not expect it, and be adventurous.
So Jay from Los Angeles asks, "Sometimes I just freeze at the lighting desk when creating a cue. What is the first channel you call up when writing a light cue?" Okay, I must say, this is my all-time favorite question in the almost two years we've been doing this show, which is pretty amazing.
Are you going to answer it?
Yes, I am.
Because I'm curious if you're going to say what I'm going to say or what Steve's going to say.
I'm sure we're all going to say the same thing. The first channel you call up, the first light you call up.
Well, maybe it's a trick question.
The first channel, the first light you call up is the most important light. It is the key light. It is the light that says what you're trying to say. And I see that my students, a lot of times, all of a sudden there's mud on stage because they're piling on 30, 40, 50 lights. I look up and I say, what are all these lights doing on? There are like 30 lights on and most of them are 12%. What is going on?
Right, exactly.
So, nothing's at full. Everything's at I said, this is what you got to do. And I don't understand how. And, you know, and to be quite honest, this happens to me sometimes, is that I always call up the most important light, but then I pile on some stuff and I lose the effect of the light. So I always tell them 1 through 200 at zero.
Right, start over.
Now, bring up the most important light and bring it to full. Not the 57. Not the 62.
40. Their favorite level is 40. 40, everything's at 40 and 60. 40 and 60.
Can you bring channel 23 to 20%? Take it to 30%. Take it to 40%. Take it to full! Now you hear me.
I'm with you, David. Same here. Be bold. Make a choice.
Take it to full! I have an F word before that. I'm not saying it on this podcast. Take it to full. You know, I just don't get it. I don't understand. You can always take it down.
No, you know what? I had a line about this week. Can I just throw this out there? I don't know where I read it. Maybe one of you guys might have said it or posted it. See with your eyes. Don't see with your mind. See with your eyes. When they're bringing this stuff up in these little increments, like, do you see anything changing?
Yeah, see with your heart. You got to feel it. You got to feel it. If you know, a lot of times I do cues that has one light in it. All right? Yeah, you could do that. There's just because you have 300 lights hung doesn't mean you have to use them all, especially in the same cue. So, you know. Yep.
At the same time at 12 degrees.
At 12%.
12 points and all flooded out.
All flooded out. Right. You know, everything is like all pacocta. No, you got to just. If you need a little bit of fill light, bring it in. That's why you have that front light or box boom or whatever. But bring that light that says the meaning of that moment on to full. And let that light tell the story.
I couldn't agree more. But I was going to give a different answer. I think your answer about the most important light is a really good one. I just went in a different direction. Now, I want to hear Steve. I'm going to hang back.
I'm going to say there's a saying in the moving light world, you know, if you have to take your light down to 50%, you picked the wrong light.
That's good. I like that. That's good. I like that. Well, I was thinking, I think David really has the right answer, but I was thinking from a compositional perspective. If I'm painting the stage, I tend to like to, let's say it's, I don't know, you know, it's, I don't have a strong feeling yet about the moment. I start with the psych. I start with upstage and I work my way downstage. So I might start with the background, then I'll put in the backlight, then the side light, and then maybe diagonal front. So it's just from a procedural standpoint, when I look at the image, I want if I was painting, I start with that and work my way down, and the last thing is the front fill. That's just sort of like maybe a generic answer, but I think David's answer is actually better.
You know, I think if you always remind yourself that you are creating the space, you are revealing the space, that sometimes right. you don't need a psych, sometimes you don't need a side light, sometimes you right. don't need a front right. light. You know, you are creating that space that the audience is perceiving, and you're creating the atmosphere. And really it is, you know, I don't know if I ever work as a in a way that is sort of a process, a rote process. You know, I usually know what moments, what lights I'm going to use for what moments. Sometimes I don't, and it comes to me. You know, it's just one of those things.
Yeah.
Maybe this
yeah.
moment needs a diagonal cross light, or maybe this right. needs a diagonal backlight, or maybe this needs an up light. You know, whatever. But that is the light I bring the up to full, and I
right.
think that's why.
Right.
A lot of directors enjoy working with me because you're wasting their time if you bring something to like the 30%, then you slowly bring it up. No, just take it to full. Show the director what that light's doing and then bring it down mm-hmm. if you want to. Bring it down to 70%.
Right.
So, yeah, I learned that actually from Ken Billington, from assisting Ken,
yeah.
because Ken was great. This is back before you had like two digits to work with for intensity. You had like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 full, right? And
right.
and it's, sometimes you get fancy, go 6.5, right? But Ken was even better. Ken, because I think it was because, A, he believed in this. He believes in these really strong moments and strong lights. But also, he had to work fast, and he would work really fast. So he would have lights go to 3, 5, 7 or full, mm-hmm. right? And it worked.
Yeah.
It was amazing. Now, I'm sure he does it differently now because I'm talking back in the 80s. But it's about really just taking it and being bold and go for it.
You're talking about the first light you
yeah,
turn on.
Yeah, or any light. Right?
Just
any
the
light.
The one that is the statement
any
light.
Any light. Yeah,
light.
The key light. And then you could bring something to 20% right. or bring something to 30%.
You could also do that with your times. A 3 count, a 6 count, a 9 count, you know, a 10 count's boring, a 5 count's boring. Make it 7. Make it 4.
7.23. And you know, and don't forget that you could have discrete times for every single light and every parameter in those lights. So
right.
open your mind up and experiment.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm done with my soapbox. Onward to the next question.
Masa from Turkey asks, is it really important to understand everything about physics to be a lighting designer? I was always bad in science. You know, I wasn't much of a science person either. I couldn't even do arithmetic. Forget about algebra, you know. And then she's saying everything about physics. Well, I don't even know if Stephen Hawking understood everything about physics. I think a little bit of it is probably helpful. You know, I think if you have a medium, you're a painter, you're a sculptor, you're a costume person, you're a photographer, you have to sort of understand your medium to a point. Do you have to, how deep do you have to drill down? I think it depends on interest. I mean, for me, I wasn't taught very little about the physics of light growing up and being a stage designer. And then when I got into the museum work well, let me just say this. Working with light on small scale, whenever you put something under a microscope, you understand it more deeply, you look more deeply at it. And so I did that. And I think it does help me as a designer, as a teacher, to understand it. But I wouldn't let it get in the way of your heart, then your soul and your spirit. I think just enough for what you're ready to understand.
I agree with Stan. I think it depends on your curiosity. If you're curious, you should do it. Hopefully you are curious. I knew very little about physics. Other than gravity, I do understand gravity, the laws of gravity. When I went to high school, I understood that if I was standing up and I fell down, I'd probably fall down hard. So,
it would hurt.
But I got curious. So I wasn't really into biology, but I was into, believe it or not, aeronautical science. I wanted to fly. Kidding. Yeah. You know, we built an airplane in high school. And cool. Our science teacher flew it. He took it up for the test flight, and he couldn't turn it. The cables got stuck, and he ended up crashing into the Everglades. That's a whole other story.
That explains a lot of things.
Thank God he went up, not a student. But no, seriously, and I was interested in that sort of thing. So wherever your curiosity is, if you're going to be a lighting designer, you need to know a certain amount of physics. There's no doubt about it, especially about lights or how we perceive light, how we adjust to light, how our mind adjusts to light. So Stan is right. Read those books. They're really good. And Stan turned me on to one of them, which was fantastic.
Margaret Livingstone.
It's a great book. And, I really understood a lot about my own research. I was just actually doing some research at USITT about color with Wendy from ETC. And it was really, really interesting talking to a real expert on color. And I'm curious. I just am curious about color because that's what I use all the time. That's what we all use. We all use color.
You know, I just keep coming back to that same thing. If you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room. So you work with light. Don't you think like Da Vinci understood his pigments? Don't you think that Michelangelo understood his chisels and marble and how those things behaved? Yeah. I mean, of course you do. I mean, really, if I'm going to be truly honest, of course you do. Don't you want to understand everything about your medium?
But you don't need to be a total science geek.
You're not going to become a scientist, right? Yeah.
But you should know about your tools. And that's what Stan is saying. And I've learned a lot from Stan. I tell my students all the time, if you're going to, I know you don't like listening to light talk, but you should, because just listening to Stan, you're going to learn so much. Because I learn so much from listening from Stan every single week. Steve, not so much, but Stan, definitely.
Well, that's a high compliment. I learned a lot from listening to you guys. I think that's one of the things that makes the show. I listen to the show every Saturday morning because I go back and really pay attention to what, one, did I say anything stupid, but also, what you guys have to say, because you have come from different worlds and experiences that I don't have. And I'm by nature, as Steve has said before, quite aptly about students, curiosity. Man, if you don't have curiosity, I don't know why you're living.
Hang on. I just want to say that's kind of harsh. That was kind of harsh. If you're not curious, you shouldn't be living. That's a little harsh.
Well, some people just exist. You exist. People.
Well,
exist
if you're not
sometimes.
Curious, is the brain working?
Are you out there with like a hammer, like whack-a-mole, getting non-curious people?
I would like that hammer. I would like to do that actually. That's actually a pretty good idea, but that's a whole nother story. Let's move on.
You are listening to Light Talk, and we are the Lumen Brothers. And this week, Light Talk is sponsored by...
Hey, from way up in the Texas Panhandle, it's Total Bastard Productions. The good men and women of Total Bastard understand how stressful the summer touring season can be. Sometimes things get out of hand. Things are said in the heat of the moment, and at the end of the night, the long bus ride can be both tense and awkward. That is why Total Bastard Productions is offering a free therapy pet with every tour we build. Our goal is to improve the lives of stagehands and designers by making sure they get to travel with a loving, cuddly prairie dog. You heard me right. TBP is throwing in a black-tailed prairie dog. This little rodent will love you for the grumpy sumbitch you are. And each morning, his annoying chirping and high-pitched bark will wake you right up at sunrise so you never miss a load-in. And brother, I do mean sunrise. The black-tailed prairie dog is well adapted to lighting designers. Using its dirometric color vision, it can detect poor color choices. Then, using a special high-pitched call, it alerts other prairie dogs... and you, to the aforementioned poor color choice. Let us send you a couple today, and in no time you will have 8. Then every 38 days you will have even more prairie dogs to love. Yes, sir, in less than 80 days you'll have 64. And in another 38 days you could have 500. Then set them free all across America. Outlet malls, truck stops, biker bars. Share the love. Then... Just like West Texas, you can have 100 miles of prairie dog towns in your community. That's right, fall on your face every time you step in a prairie dog hole. Now you know why Texans shout, yippee-ki-yay, mother!
Beep!
Beep!
From the Panhandle. Total Bastard Productions. Ask about our Mexican Prairie Dog 3-for-1 special. How do you know you're getting a genuine Total Bastard Productions Prairie Dog? Just look for the caveman holding a roll of gel on the cage.
On the cage. Okay.
I was wondering if he was going to say it. So okay. Because it was on the script, and I'm thinking, where's Ann?
Well, I just want to say right now, that is at least a 3 Top Hat sponsor.
I agree. With
it's pretty
with
funny.
With an eyelash. With an
funny.
Eyelash and funny. Some flocking.
By the way, speaking of eyelashes, I am quoting right now, Steve, you should pay attention to this, through City Theatrical, half hat and full hat with inside flocking on for the 660s and the 640s show lines.
Whoa. Is that a hat?
Currently being measured and quoted by Gary Fales.
Is that technically a hat? Or is it a bib?
Called it that.
I think it's a bib.
He called that the hat.
You know, City Theatrical is dead to me. I just want to say. Can City Theatrical provide me with any prairie dogs? A black-tailed prairie dog, a Mexican prairie dog, a Gunnings prairie dog, the white-tailed prairie dog, or my favorite, the Utah prairie dog? No, they can't do it.
I bet they can provide you with a flocked prairie dog, though.
Yeah, flock that prairie
dog.
They
can do a flocked prairie dog. Custom flocking. Well, I have to say that now it's time to go back to Light Talk.
Speaking of prairie dogs, those ducks are back. And that means it's time for our Let's Talk About segment.
Uh-oh.
So we're going to have a...
This is going to be a long one.
No, it's not going to be long. It's going to be concise. And I don't know. Anyway, we're going to talk about USITT. Now, I'm going to just start off right from the top.
Wait a minute. I got to stop you. We have an international audience. You need to explain what USITT stands for.
USITT, United States Institute of Theater Technology. And I have to say that last week's show, I was pretty rough on USITT.
Me too.
Yes, Stan was too. We both said that USITT is on our 12-year rotation.
Cycle. We're sorry.
I'm sorry.
It's better.
It's much better. It's much better, and I loved it. I had such a great time there, and I was always say, if you want to see something new, go to LDI. Don't waste your time at USITT. Well, let me tell you something. I was dead wrong, because there were several things that were new there, technology-wise, that were amazing to me. Probably the most talked-about product there and had the most buzz on the floor was ETC's new Augment 3D upgrade for their EOS operating system. Now, it's in alpha. It's not even in beta yet, but they're saying it should be ready by the fall. That's what they're saying. But it is pretty cool. What it basically is, I mean, how many years ago, Stan? 22 years ago, ETC had a product called Emphasis.
Oh, yeah, it did. That's right.
And I
even upgraded my system at Florida with it. The concept was beautiful.
Yeah, what was the concept, Stan?
Well, the concept was to take the most innovative piece of software at the time, which was WYSIWYG, and integrate that into an ETC console, where basically the interface for the lights were in WYSIWYG, and vice versa. If you were to select the light the normal way on a keyboard or through a fader, they would also select it in the software. And there was complete bi-directional communication. And I think it was ahead of its time. And I'll always say this, I kind of feel like I'm often ahead of my time, and that is not an easy place to be because people think you're, you know, odd.
Nobody thinks you're odd.
Oh, I think I'm odd. I think I take a lot of risk when I take on something that nobody else is doing yet. But and nobody wants to hear when you tell them, I was talking about that 10 years ago. Nobody wants to hear I told you so. So it's not a happy place to be. But the failure of that and from was that clients thought they were going to get their theater or their space built for them in 3D. So it was a visualizer too. So when you turned on the light, you saw it in the visualizer. You could work while the work lights were on, and all of the things that we now take for granted. The failure was that the expectation of the clients was not of the purchases wasn't aligned with what they were delivering.
Right.
And when
right.
there was technical issues, there wasn't a clear line of reporting between the two companies. Who was going to answer the phone? Who knew it well enough to help people both on the console side and the visual and the WYSIWYG side? So that's a long time ago. Augment 3D is an embedded visualizer into the EOS brand of lighting consoles.
And it's also a 3D drafting program. You can import 3D
objects, yes,
and designs. If you have do a lighting plot, a stage design, a lighting plot in Vectorworks, 3D Vectorworks, it will import it into your EOS system. And that's from any EOS system that is from the Ion up with the display port. It has to have a display port. You can move lights around. You can activate a light with a touch screen. You
sure.
can point to the light and then point to where you want to focus, and it will focus there.
Yep.
It will remember adjustments, like if you want things not focused on the floor, and
right.
you want focused at 5 feet up
yep.
where the hotspot is, it will do that.
Yep.
It's a very, very powerful program, and the visualizer, from what I saw there, was sublime. It was as good as anything I've seen out there personally.
I saw it in grayscale. I didn't see it with materiality and color. Did you?
Yeah, I mean it was really nice. From what I've seen, again, what I saw, I was very, very impressed.
Well, the good news is we're all gonna see it in June as a beta in 3.0 EOS, and then I'm sure we'll get better after that. And I think but you know, I don't want to rag on it too much, but it's sort of like it's about time.
They also have a wonderful feature called the Wand.
That's kind of cool.
Which basically turns your iPhone or your Android into a pointing and focusing device. So you go out on stage, you can look at your screen, your iPhone screen, and point it at a light, and you click on it, and then there's a little button that says, Find Me. You click on that, and the light focuses on you.
Mm-hmm.
So you can basically go boom, 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 boom for those five lights. Find Me, it hits you, and you can say, "Focus, record focus point one." Yeah, but you know what's also great, something that we haven't told our listeners? That Augment 3D is free.
Yes.
It's free to any EOS user and free to any student. You don't even have to own an EOS.
Right.
You can just download it on your computer, and there's your visualizer. So that's pretty cool.
And I'm told that in 2 weeks, the students who signed up this year for free academic WYSIWYG Perform will be getting a response via email so that they can get their logins. So that everybody's doing that.
So let's talk about the high-end SolarFrame 1000. That's
like
also
it.
A new...
I'm specifying a bunch of those.
They're really nice. I was very impressed. But they're brand new, and they're just coming... they're just hitting the shores now. They have a wonderful, wonderful gobo arrangement in there, I must say. And they're very powerful. I'm very impressed with that light. And then that brings us to our friends at German Light Products. Stan and I had a good time over in their booth.
The booths. They had all the great booths.
Well, that's the great. You know, a lot of these companies, they hang fabric to show you the color rendering of their lights. Or like Stan suggested, put up charts, you know, with color. So I do a really good A-B comparison, you know, with the light hits the color. But what they had is they got a bunch of bourbons, bourbon bottles, and they put them on an authentic keg that where they distill bourbon, and that they shine the lights on it. It was really great. You know, this one thing about that company, I love this company, I must say. And I started talking about them 2 years ago at LDI because I just loved their whole demonstration, their attitude. They don't really take themselves that seriously.
They take the work seriously because the lights are great.
The lights are fantastic. I love their products. But, you know, they come up with a fan. I mean, really, the Force 4, whatever it's called, which is great. But they've got two new products that I got to talk about. I took my students down to GLP, and Brian, who was showing us the equipment, amazing stuff. And their new light is the S350, which is a medium-powered moving light, LED moving light. But they have solved hold on to your hats, guys. The diffusion issue has been solved.
Tell us how they do it, David.
Yes, I'll tell you how they do it. Most manufacturers put their diffusion filters close to the gate, right? With everything else there. So what you usually get, and you can see this in most moving lights with diffusion, is you get a sharp edge, and then you start seeing a cloud around that sharp edge, but the edge is still sharp. And then it gets a little cloudier, but the edge is still sharp. Then all of a sudden, it falls into softness, all right? That's not proper diffusion. They solve the problem by moving their diffusion mechanism toward the front of the light. Where diffusion normally goes, it's actually right behind the optical system. So it's far away from the gate, much farther away than the other, you know, the color and the gobo mechanisms are. So that's how they solve the problem.
But wait, there's more. They use two different levels of diffusion material. So from 0 to 50%, you get the first one, what they call, I guess, the medium frost or diffusion. And then at above 50%, a second one starts to engage, and it's just like butter. Like
it's beautiful.
Butter.
It's beautiful. And there's one more company that I want to talk about real quick. Stan was talking earlier about going and finding the little companies. There's a little mom and pop company called QList. And QList is a software program that allows you to upload PDF files of scripts and scores and things like that, and actually electronically place light cues, sound cues, projection cues in there with descriptions if you want. But what's really cool is that you can have like five or six users on the same show. You have a stage manager, sound designer, lighting designer, assistant stage managers. They could all be linked in through the internet, through a cloud. And when someone changes the location of the cue, it automatically updates to everybody's cue list immediately. Josh Epstein and his wife, Beth Johnson, developed this. And Josh is a local lighting designer here in LA. And I think it's gonna be great. I really do. That it's a monthly subscription price, but only one person needs a subscription if you're working on a show, and then I think up to six people or seven people can use it.
Right.
So go to their website and take a look at it. And finally, Stan, why don't you tell us about Blacktrax?
Well, we would just say I didn't think that Blacktrax was something that I was interested in for my institution. I thought it was a high end product for industrials and rock shows and really big budgets. And when I start to really understand what it is and the fact that it sits on top of WYSIWYG and what it does with sensors and real-time tracking, I didn't know it was being used on King Kong on Broadway because it was more efficient than tracking the head of Kong with moving lights. It's blew me away in terms of what it can do. And I would just recommend that everybody take a look at the video on what those capabilities are. And what we did hear from Gil Densham, who also needs to be on the show, and I'm going to call him the futurist because he's the guy behind all this forward thinking, that what he told David and I that we really can't talk about, but what is now being installed in certain broadcast studios changes everything. So in 10 years, well, let's just say this, that if we think moving lights were big, moving lights will seem quaint.
Moving lights may be obsolete.
Perhaps.
Perhaps. And I don't think it's going to be 10 years.
You think it's faster?
I think it's maybe faster. It may be. I don't know that much about how fast this technology is moving, but it seems to be moving pretty damn fast.
Yeah.
Wendy told me that she thinks it's going to be about within 2 years when LEDs reach a point of color rendering of tungsten halogen fixture lamps.
Oh, sure. Yeah, well, the level of efficiency that what Gil talked to about, we have to be a little cagey about what we say, and how that would change labor, how that would change where the attention goes, how that would change what a rig is pretty a tectonic change. In the same way that moving lights were a tectonic change to the world, this is a similar order of magnitude.
It does depend, though, on some major developments in technology, so it may not happen. But it's great that people are thinking this way, thinking out of the box. So, Steve, you have the last question of the day.
And it comes all the way from the UK, and that is Robin. And Robin says, how do you mentor students once they graduate from your programs?
Good question.
Nice question.
I don't. I stay in touch. We chat. They don't want to hear from me. I look at their work. They invite me to shows. I invite them to mine. But, you know, at some point, I think you walk away from your students' lives. I mean, they're growing. They're developing in ways. I don't know, Robin. If I look at a student's work 10 years from now, I don't know if they care to have me mentor or kibitz on their work anymore. And if anything, they've grown better and better and better than I am. So maybe they need to mentor me at some point.
I'll just answer the question a little differently. I don't mentor my students, nor do I seek to mentor my students after school. But what I do seek to, and I'm somewhat successful at, is they turn from my students to my friends and colleagues. And so I really do like to stay in touch with them. And not all, but many stay in touch with me. Some of the conversation is personal. And some of the conversation is, hey, I'm working on this. You have an idea about that? So there'll be a question, you know, a professional back and forth, collegial. I just had two former students come back because they were on campus and they're both on the national tour of Finding Neverland. And they said, hey, we're coming back. Would you like a masterclass on national touring for your students? And I'm like, of course. So we went out to so I like to keep the relationship if I can. And that's just a bond that I think is lovely. It enriches my life. And so I got students going back 20 years who, in fact, at USITT, David Scott, who you met, Scott was a graduate student in 1999. And we don't talk all the time, but we certainly reach out. So I like the camaraderie. I like the friendship. But mentoring, I think I'm done with mentoring once they're moving on to professionalism. But the friendship and the relationship, I love having. I hope that they will all come to my retirement party and we'll have a great celebration when that time comes. So I like that bond.
And something that Chris Borecki used to say all the time is when you graduate, you turn from a student to a colleague. Yeah. And that's a wonderful thing.
Exactly.
Well, guys, that Hammond organ solo in the background tells us that once again, you spent another morning listening to Light Talk. Check out our website on lighttalk.org for future guests. And be sure to follow us on Facebook and subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. That way you will not miss a second of Light Talk fun.
No guarantee is offered regarding the accuracy of any statements or opinions made on this podcast.
And remember, if you're silly enough to choose to litigate us, our brand spanking new, really, really high-tech law firm of Fleck, Flock, Flair, and Glare, and their paralegal Snoot will defend us until our retirement funds are depleted.
Light Talk is written and produced by the Lumen Brothers, coming to you from Long Beach, Gainesville, and the Republic of Texas.
And be sure to tune in next week for our second anniversary show, 104, when we've done 104 episodes. Insane.
All that.
No new sponsors.
There's and
a no
whole new bunch sponsor. Of sponsors.
A bunch of sponsors.
Light Talk, broadcasting questionable Lumen knowledge and humor around our world.
So we'll all see you next Saturday morning. Bye-bye from Light Talk.
Take it easy, everybody.
Light Talk.